Hi everybody, and welcome to the KTPF Community Show, live in the hub at www.ktpf.co.uk.
Hi, my
online
name is
paranormal talk show, brought to you in association with the UK Shadow Seekers and the Keeping the Paranormal Friendly Community.
Hi, my name is Suzanne.
Hello, Steve.
Established since 2007, the KTPF is a dedicated, ongoing community, which is not just there for when you're experiencing animosity from others. We welcome every paranormal investigator and enthusiast alike, including hobbyists, scientists, and psychic mediums from around the globe, to join in as we cover this vast, fascinating subject, encouraging you to share information, advice, and most importantly, friendship. Remember, collaboration, not competition.
Talk radio.
You hear us, we hear you.
Yeah, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome again to another evening of delving into the unknown. Isn't it, Steve?
Absolutely. We've got loads in the chat room today.
We have. Hold on, we've got a recent come up here. Who's this? Hold on. We have a... What's this? Not a lot. Hold on. 2 seconds. John Mike is on, unless he's not flicked it up.
Hello.
There you go.
Can you hear me out there in Radio Land?
Good evening. Oh, how are you? Let's see who's in the hub at the moment. We've been chatting here for amongst ourselves between Doc Savage, otherwise known as MNPIG, which is Minnesota Paranormal Investigation Group in the good old US of A. And we've also got Norwich John there, which is Ghost Rider 2873. And we've been having a bit of fun for the last 15 minutes, 20 minutes, chatting away. Because we seem to be doing that now, don't we? So as we're doing the old test, we get people coming on and chatting away to us and telling us everything sounds okay. We had 6 people listening or watching while we were testing.
Or doing something. Now we've got 11.
So let's see who we've got now. We've got Green Lee, okay, which is Reiki Debs' other half, who is there as well. She says, yo. And he says, good evening, peeps. We've got Nigel 333. Hi, everyone, he says. And Hobbs 1974, which is his better half.
Yeah, that's the lovely Helen.
Yes. Simply Joe has popped her head in. Hiya. I hope you're all right. Anybody else that's there? Hi, wife. What's that? Get me a brew on. There you go. You've been giving your orders there, Debs. So everyone's saying hello to everyone. And... okay, so we'll be keeping an eye on that. I hope you've had a great week, and we've not been doing too bad, have we, Steve? We've tried to have a restful week because Vinny's been away, so I haven't really had much to do on the sites trying to build them back.
Peaceful future.
Yeah, because I couldn't do much, and Vinny being away, it was not too bad. Lee says he's got more chance of Satan skating to work than getting Ranky Debs to doing him a cuppa. Is that because we've started? Maybe you should have asked beforehand. So, as I say, tonight we've got a bit of a show for you tonight. We're going to be covering quite a lot of genre tonight, to be honest with you, because we've got a lady coming on at 8:30 via Skype, hopefully. Her internet is actually down. Bless her, she talk about keen. She's asked her next door neighbour if she can use their internet, so she's plugged into them. So, but we have got a landline number just in case. Okay. As I say, she's going to be she's quite a jack of all trades, isn't she? A mother for a start, and wife.
Mother, housewife, author, white witch. And she also makes a lot of jewellery and things.
Yeah, she does, crystals. Doesn't she? Yeah, she's a tarot reader. And what else does she do? Spiritual advisor as well. So, so we should have quite a bit to talk about. We're going to start off with one subject and lead to another and another and then find out what she's been up to and what she's going to be doing.
She's into the... Fairy folklore.
Yes, this is another thing. We're going to be talking all things goblins and ghouls and goblins and fairy folk of some type of another, which is why we've also got in Fortean Researcher with us tonight, all the way from Liverpool, Mr. John Hall.
Hello out there.
So you're into all this fairy folklore, aren't you?
Yeah, I certainly am. But so just for we kick off on that, there's an interesting report just come through the other day or so, saying NASA with the Discovery module on Mars, as they made a almighty discovery which they're holding back till it's been certified or quantified or whatever, and they're going to release this information towards the end of the year or beginning next year, which you know, the old life on Mars stuff may actually be actually put out, and it'll be a sort of world-changing event according to the news feed.
So that's if we've survived the Mayan attack on the 21st, I take it.
The Mayan's not going to...
Well, Planet X is going to crash, apparently. Something else is going to happen.
Earthquakes.
Yeah.
Tsunamis.
Yes.
Everything.
Yeah, 2012, the whole film.
Cats having sex with dogs.
Is she? That's a new one. Or do you mean the animal variety?
Do you not remember the thing from Ghostbusters?
Oh yeah.
Oh right, yes, 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 definitely.
Cats and dogs having sex. Total mayhem.
The big freeze. Think day after tomorrow. Yes.
There's another Ghostbusters film in the offing.
Yeah, there is actually. Yeah, another one. Right. Well, talking about NASA, Nigel says. NASA says. NASA says they are making the statement from the White House on December the 2nd. So yes.
So just before everything goes bad.
Get the welcome mats out for the Martians.
Yeah.
So they're going to come on and say, yes, we've been lying to you. There are Martians and Planet X is just a couple of miles away.
Yeah, but come on. Like you said, this ain't going to happen surely, because at the end of the day, people are watching the skies, aren't they? So they're going to know if there's going to be a bloody great big planet coming towards us.
It should be well in view by now.
It should be, shouldn't it? So, you know, unless they're looking in the wrong direction, mind you.
Well, there's people looking all over the world. So
well, this is what I'm saying. So,
if Nubra actually existed, to the extent that people have been saying, it would have been seen long ago.
This hasn't. So,
having said that, the cold planet that they've just discovered. It's quite big apparently, but it's just floating around. It's a free planet.
Yeah, several rogue planets. They say through.
They're saying that could be Nubra, but that's miles away and going in the wrong direction.
Well, Reiki Debs has just turned around and said it's an invisible planet.
Yeah, it's got a force shield around it, an Australia spacecraft. Yeah.
Yeah, it's being cloaked.
And it looks like something else.
Oh, I don't know.
Chameleon. Camouflage. Yeah.
So we're going to have quite an interesting show tonight.
Reiki Debs actually said something there that I've not heard for a long time.
What's that?
It tastes better if you make it.
Oh, right, yeah, concerning the copper. Yeah. Nigel says, unless it comes to another dimension, think dimensions. Oh, here we go again. Here in his portal. So I'm going to have to get hold of you sometime and get sort out about going up there. Probably after the weekend, if that's possible. Yep. We'll have to contact each other, Nigel, see if there's a time and a place we can go. And also, there's an idea of us going on to...
And then contact Richard to see if he can make it.
The middle of nowhere next year.
Yes.
And incorporate in the portal as part of that investigation.
Well, as far as the team's concerned.
Yeah, as far as the team's
I'll
concerned.
I'll be on for that one, Nigel. Yeah.
John's up for that one as well. God, it's going to be packed.
It's coming through the portal system.
Yeah, that's the escape route.
It's the Klingons and a cloaking device.
Well,
that's what Green Lee says.
I agree.
You do?
Yes.
Right. Okay.
They're on the starboard bow.
They are. They're bloody somewhere, I tell you.
Well, what about that little village in France that everybody's supposed to
be
on?
Oh, yeah. It's built on... The village is on an extinct volcano.
So it's the only place that's going to be safe.
According to the...
Because the aliens are going to come and pick everybody up.
Yeah.
Well, that's if you're there, you know. Or are they going to pick everyone up? Or are they going to be selective, you know?
Yeah, well, according to the police and everything, the government, they're not going to be letting anybody in. It's closed to everyone. The only people you're going to find there is the police. So don't bother going.
The police and the villagers.
Yeah, so don't bother going. So that's what they've said. Okay? So... Don't put it into the computer, for God's sake. It'll go bang. All that energy you just put.
I just sent it to Nigel's cat.
Oh, right. Okay.
He's feeling quite sick, not well. Oh,
poor son. Right.
His UFO cat.
Oh, bless.
I take it he calls it that because it knows when UFOs are about.
Maybe. Actually, this is what the Mayans say. There's life, green, but not as we know it. Did I ring that back to front?
No, Nigel, that's not the middle of nowhere. It might be football-wise, but not where we're
going. Right, John, so is the middle of nowhere Rochdale? No, it's actually just outside Settle.
No, he said, is it Rochdale football ground?
Spotland, yeah.
Spotland. Right, so as I say, we've got quite a bit coming on tonight. So got quite a bit to talk about with Catherine, with what she does and doesn't do, and what her fascination is. So what we'll do is, well... I am doing some observations.
Excellent.
It used to be called Paranormal News, but it's a bit about everything now.
It's now observations.
It's now observations.
The question is, what did you see?
I didn't see nothing.
What did you observe?
I observed all this on the internet, so I've picked it up and talk about it tonight. I've observed this in my internet emails. So when they've come on my newsfeed. Or rather, you got this one, but I went and Googled it.
Okay, go for it.
Right, okay, ladies and gentlemen. Ancient model aircraft. I don't know whether you've seen this before, but flights have been the dream of humankind since they watched in awe as birds soared effortlessly. I'll get that word out in a minute. It looks better when you type it. Through the sky. But according to history, two Frenchmen in the 1780s achieved lighter than air flight when they were lifted into the air in a hot air balloon near Paris. Then powered heavier than air flight became the goal. And although it was theorized that heavier than air flight was possible in as early as the 13th century and in the 16th century when Leonardo da Vinci, that man again, he's been a problem for the past few years at the moment. Designed a winged aircraft and a crude kind of helicopter. It wasn't until the Wright brothers made their first successful flight at Kitty Hawk in 1903 with powered flight powered flight became a reality.
I don't remember that bit.
I added. Sorry.
Sorry to interject there, but apparently all through the... 17 and 1800s, there was mystery airships sighted all over the USA and over the UK and Europe, which had they looked very similar to modern airships.
Yeah.
But they done things more like a tribute to UFOs.
Yeah.
And the one particular thing they used to do is drop anchors, and several of them being left over the UK in various places. They might be one to track it down, but the occupants used to do very much the same thing as ufonauts, you know,
go down,
take people away. Spotlights uh-huh. appeared, you know. So this thing went over the whole of the USA, apparently. Don't know, a lot of it was hoaxes as well.
Yeah.
But there were several reports in newspapers and stuff.
Mm. And there was a lot of UFOs painted in Renaissance pictures as well.
It'd be sort of shields and swords and that sort of thing.
Well, there are artifacts belonging to ancient Egypt, Egyptians and Central American cultures that looks amazingly like modern aircraft. In 1898, a particular size 6-inch wooden object was found in a tomb at Saqqara, if that's pronounced right, in Egypt, that dated back to about 200 BC. The object had a body of a fuselage, 6 inches wings that curved downwards slightly, a fixed rudder and a tail. It looked very much like a modern aircraft or glider, but since airplanes had not yet been invented in 1898, never mind ancient Egypt, it was labelled as a model of a bird and stored away in the basement of the Cairo Museum. It is also necessary to point out that Egyptians are known to have nearly always made scale models of projects and objects which they plan to create or build. Experts believe the object is so aerodynamic that it's actually able to glide. The small object discovered in Central America is made of gold and could easily be mistaken for a model of a delta wing aircraft or even a space shuttle. It even features what looks like a pilot's seat. Was this just a child's toy, or was it a scale model of an aircraft the Egyptians planned to build or did build? If they did build a full-scale version of an aircraft, we are told by archaeologists and historians that no evidence existed for it. But this case seems to be an exception, living in the midst of the rather unimaginative or rigid paradigm of contemporary science. So there's a thing, food for thought, isn't it?
And John, Nigel was saying that there was many airships seen in the Wild West.
That's right, yeah, that's what I was getting at, yeah.
Mm. So maybe there's more to all this stuff that we know.
Not just ships, but also creatures from the other side, or sort of like they're described as pterodactyls, which had been seen and shot. It's almost like a scene out of the Valley of the Guanji.
Oh, I love that film.
Which has a large pterodactyl, which is, you know, killed. And the large dinosaur gets it.
I like the little horse in that, funny enough.
The Eohippus.
So, well, I hope you can hear me all right, because I've just put my mic back on its perch. Right, well, the next one I found out is according to the Austrian Times. Funny enough, I believe we've been in that, haven't we?
Yes.
Yeah, when it came to Bran Castle. All right, council have issued a vampire alert. Good evening, Derry D. You're not missing much,
are we? Hi, Derry.
Council issue a vampire alert. Sales of garlic are booming in Western Serbia after the local council issued a public health warning that a vampire was on the loose. The warning came after an old ruined mill, said to once have been the home of the country's most famous monster in the form of a vampire, Savanovic, collapsed. Savar Savanovic was said to have lived in the old water mill on the Rogosica River. And I'm sure he does this on purpose with these big words, foreign words. At Zarozhi Villa, some villa, okay, on the municipality of Bajina Basta, something like that. Where he drank the blood of anybody that came to the mill to mill their grain. The water mill was brought by the local Jagodic family. You did this on purpose, didn't you? And they were too scared to use it as a mill. But discovering it was a gold mine, that they started advertising for tourists to come and visit it, but always during the day. But the family were worried about carrying building work on the mill because they were scared they might disturb the vampire or unleash his wrath if his home was messed around with, and now the property has collapsed through lack of repair. But for locals, it has sparked rumours that the vampire is now free once again. Local mayor, I deleted the name for obvious reasons.
Yeah, you can't pronounce it.
Local mayor had admitted that people were worried. Everybody knows the legend of this vampire, and thought that he is now homeless and looking for somewhere else, and possibly other victims. Is terrifying people. We are all frightened. He added that it was all very well for people who didn't live in the area to laugh at their fears, but he said nobody in the region was in any doubt that vampires do exist. He confirmed that the local council had advised all villagers to put garlic on their doors and windows to protect them from the vampire, as it was well known that they can't stand the smell. He added, we have also reminded them to put a holy cross in every room in the house. Villagers who cashed in catering to tourists' fascination by the legend of Savanovic says they now wish they had left the place well alone. Well, there you have it. Funny you should say that last bit. When we was in Romania this year, they was telling us that years ago, this Bram Stoker and what have you, and Christopher Lee films and what have you about the vampire, people used to flock there after it became all Hollywoody, and they were like, where's the vampire, where's the vampire? And the villagers are there going, hey, what are you on about? I don't know what you're on about. And then when they cottoned on to what the hell was going on in the Western world, so to speak, in Hollywood and what have you, when people were going there again, they were going, ah, yes, I remember the vampire. Yes, he got my daughter. He's got two punches in the neck, my wife. She become a vampire, blah, blah, blah. Just to cash in on it. It was quite funny the way he said it anyway. Probably not as funny as I've just done. But... but I don't know, but as I say, I can just imagine that there, though, you know what I mean? So,
well, people are not daft, they're gonna work out that, especially in what is essentially a poor country, they're gonna earn some money somehow.
Well, this is it now. The last observation I've got is actually a heads up, okay, guys. Another one, we've also got one coming up in a few weeks' time. I've got to sort out Kerry from Bomber County Paranormal. She wants to come on and talk about properties that are faking it and stuff like that. But and we mentioned last week about similar sort of thing, but this one seems to be a little bit more serious. Now, I know it's over in America again, but we do have paranormal groups here that do the same sort of thing. I myself with Steve, we went off to a potential haunting last week, which turned out to be a bit of hysteria, but that's by the by. We have done some in the past, but this one I really do want to make a point of, just to give everyone a bit of a, you know, be careful. You never know where you're going in some of these houses, and who these people are. On November the 26th or the 12th, a ghost hunter died after harmful exposure during an investigation. A few weeks ago, the Paranormal Research Society in the US were contacted by Shane Harris, a fellow paranormal investigator based in North Carolina, whose wife Sarah, also an investigator, became ill after investigating a private residence. According to Mr. Harris, the location had bat and rodent droppings. Mr. Harris believes that the air was stirred up during the investigation, and Sarah inhaled something that later infected her lungs. It rapidly reached a point where her lungs could no longer sustain themselves on their own. Sarah, if I've got that wrong, and it is Sarah, I'm sorry, was put on life support and fought a hard battle for a month. We were informed that Sarah Harris passed away around 12:30 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, I think that is, EST, American time, on Sunday, November the 25th, 2012. Mrs. Harris's untimely demise reminds us all of the real-world dangers of investigating, and Shane Harris wants to share his wife's story so that this tragedy does not repeat itself. He has begun a mission of urging investigators to wear a mask when investigating older properties. I am reaching out to the paranormal community for prayers and also so you can protect yourself against the things we cannot see that are living and breathing in the air we breathe. Please be careful, as I don't want this to happen to you. Shane Harris. The PRS would like to offer their deepest sympathies, as so are we, to Mr. Harris. His story has touched a lot of people. It's been going around Facebook and other media stuff, social media stuff, since the weekend. And apparently he's also decided to come on a Paranormal Insider radio sometime, or he was there, to tell about his wife's story. we just want to say thank thank him for putting this forward to us. We have been to some places, both private and public, that have been quite bad, haven't we?
Yeah, we have. I mean, we've had some where it's not particularly bad, but there's bats around. And
yeah, you know. Well, look at that place we used to do in Burslem when they had pigeon droppings all over the place, and pigeons were stuck upstairs as well. So, yeah. You know, well, you just don't know, do you?
I mean, that part of it was actually closed because of it, but that was, unfortunately, that was because some idiot went somewhere we were told not to.
Yeah, I know, but you know what I mean. Yeah. So it is something we do need to address as well. So just a gentle heads up there, or rather a stark one actually, because unfortunately this poor lady, she did lose her life, and it's not as if she was it was her time yet. But please be careful out there with what you do. It may be fun and what have you, and something we like doing, but there are hazards, both this kind and other health and safety wise. So please take care, and if Mr. Harris is listening, or any of his family, we would like to pass on our own condolences, and we will hope that everybody takes heed. So that's all I wanted to say. I don't know what you think out there, but
Nigel was just saying that he came down with severe breathing problems when he moved into a very old house.
Yeah, well, this is it. Yeah,
dust in the air, and then if there's rat droppings or we, you know, left around the property, or even in the open air.
No,
yeah,
this is it.
You need to get fans in there and get aired out properly. It's that's just it, though. When you go into some of these places and you just don't know.
Well, no, what you don't. Into. No.
You
so
don't deal with it, a mask and gloves and hazard suits, really.
Well, this is it. No disrespect, but we have been into private residents, which are quite what we would class as
damn right filthy.
Yeah. You know. So you don't know what's there, do you? You don't know.
You haven't got a clue.
You know, you just haven't got a clue. And
well, you don't expect something like that when you're going to someone's house.
No, you don't, do you?
You expect it to be.
Especially when they've minging, that's the word. But you know, you don't expect it when they've invited somebody around to do, you know, to help and what have you. Mm. You know, but as I say, it is something to think about. So just a precautionary there, and as I say, our condolences goes out to Mr. Harris and his family. Okay, back to the show.
Well, I have a theory, but
go on.
I haven't got time to talk about.
Go on, quick. Got a couple of minutes.
Well, it might take a bit longer than a couple of minutes.
Oh, right, okay.
Especially when people start talking about it.
Oh.
Well, we all know about this, the hollow earth theory, don't we? About the poles.
Apparently, yeah.
Yeah. Mm. I mean, there are stories that the Nazis hid themselves in it and that. But I was thinking about it the other day. But with the hollow earth, as well as all these stories about ancient beings that were here first and taught us these things. Could it be that that's where all these ancient beings have gone? The teachers, they've gone to Middle Earth, so to speak.
Never know. You just don't know until you find out for yourself.
What do you think, Nigel? You think that's where they've all gone to, and which is
alternative dimension?
Yeah, well, which is not necessarily. I mean, they do actually reckon there is actually a hole.
Yeah.
For you to go into.
Right, well, just before I call up the our guest tonight.
I've heard about it.
Yeah,
about
yeah, I mean, I read one report that I think it was someone from NASA who actually saw it. At one of the poles, I saw this big hole, and in the hole, it's just pure green.
No, I come across that, but apparently it was, according to the other reports I read, it was some sort of overlay. They put the two together, and it wasn't actually a hole. The only hole there is the ozone hole, apparently.
Yeah. Right, well, just before we call up our guest tonight, I just want to say, if you have any problem with the if you're on our main web page, sometimes it does get a bit sticky, doesn't it?
It's actually been quite good tonight.
Oh, that's all right then. But if you do have a problem, you can always go to the live stream. Helen said there's a pub called Middle Earth in Whitby.
I don't think they've gone there.
and the also Hobbits come from.
Yeah, and also
I'm looking forward to that film. I am looking forward to that one coming out.
And also if we disappear any time and it goes off, that means something's crashed and we'd have to reload again. But not reload as in all the computer. It means come out of live stream and come back again. So don't go away. It's not down to us. It's down to them.
Yeah.
And Roxy's come in and flopped herself on the floor while she's here.
Nigel just said there's a lot of underground passes that legends say leads to Agharti, which is a word I don't know.
Secret underground civilization, apparently.
Ah.
Another alternative dimension again. Yep. Put another portal, as Nigel would say.
Doc Savage in Minnesota said he was the once had to fight a hobbit goldfish that was trying to steal his ring. Right, okay. I've grabbed a clip for you to look at, okay, while I call up our next guest to because as I say, she's into everything, so I hope it comes through and you get all of it, because it's the first bit that's more appropriate. I'll see you after this.
Well, I couldn't, some Nazis have got base on the moon.
Hello.
Hi, Catherine.
Hello.
Right, we're going back on live in a minute, okay? So I'll see you. I'm just going to cue us soon, then we can be able to hear you. All right.
All right.
Right, let's get back on, hopefully. Come on, come on. Right, we're back. So that just gives you a little idea of what's going on tonight. Just a snippet of what's coming up later on. But until then, we have our guest with us on Skype. I'd like to introduce you to Miss Catherine Green. Good evening, Catherine.
Hello, everybody.
Right, hopefully, can you make sure, please, that you can hear her in the chat room, if you wouldn't mind, if everyone can answer me. Right, they're all saying hello, Catherine. Night, Joe. Bye, Joe. God, that was quick.
Yes, apparently she's had two 11-hour shifts. So
right, okay.
Bit knackered.
Right, can everybody hear Catherine? Loud and clear, that's good. Right. Right, good evening, Catherine. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you. Suzanne, how are you?
Not too bad. Right, Catherine, you're from, is it Nantwich?
Middlewich.
Middlewich. Oh,
yes.
We're talking about Middle Earth, aren't we? It's not Middle Earth, is it?
It could be.
It could be. Right, okay, so can you briefly tell us a bit about yourself? You've got quite a lot of caps that you put on there, haven't you?
I have. The main one that I'm using at the moment is author.
Oh, I thought you were going to say mother.
Well, yeah, there is that.
Okay. So you're using author at the moment.
Yes, I'm a paranormal author. Yes, I'm a mother. And I also work with spirit and... I'm studying shamanism at the moment.
Okay. So, right, first of all, let's touch on your paranormal experiences. You used to be with a group, didn't you?
I did. A few years ago, I worked with a group called Northwest Spirit Seekers.
Uh-huh.
We mainly went to venues around the northwest of the UK.
Yeah.
We did venture a bit further north and a bit further to the Midlands on a few occasions as well. And we used to do overnight ghost hunts. In lots of interesting places.
Right, okie dokie. Was there anywhere that you would consider really good that you can recommend, or any experiences that you remember?
My best ones. Yeah. I really enjoyed Belgrave Hall in Leicester.
Uh-huh.
Had lots of activity there. I don't know if you remember back in the 90s, there was a big story on the TV news when there was a ghost image caught on the CCTV at the hall.
Right.
At Belgrave Hall.
Yeah.
So when we did our investigation, we set a camera up in the same location and in the garden to try and catch it. We never captured the image on camera, but myself and three other people actually saw a white mist apparition in the garden.
Wow.
Which was the first and only time I've seen that kind of thing.
Yeah. So where do you stand now with paranormal tours and stuff? Do you still do them? Do you join other groups, or are you part of another group?
I have been with a couple of different groups on odd occasions. I've not really done that much ghost hunting recently.
No.
Mainly because I've been distracted by my toddler.
Yeah, I can understand. as I say, you class yourself as a spiritual advisor. And you're also, am I right in thinking you're a pagan witch?
I am, yes.
Right, can you explain what that's all about, please?
Yeah, basically, when I talk to people about being a witch, most people will automatically ask about Wicca.
Yeah.
And many will associate it with that. I don't follow Wicca specifically because I prefer to look at the sort of older ways, if you like. I'm kind of journeying back to our Celtic days and connecting with our ancestors from, you know, many, many centuries ago. So it's way before the sort of invention of Wicca. It follows a lot of the similar kind of ideals.
Yeah.
But I work with nature energies and spirits in every day, so basically working with the idea of following the seasons, honoring the moon cycles, the what happens when each season changes, and noticing the calendar of events on the pagan calendar.
Right, with the Beltane and everything else.
Yes, so we've got the winter solstice coming up in December on the shortest day.
It wouldn't be the 21st, would it, by any chance?
Yes, it would.
Oh, God.
Reiki Dev mentions the moon phases.
You deal with the moon phases, yeah?
Yes, I mean, I am still fairly new to it, I will admit. I only sort of accepted myself as a witch earlier this year, admittedly.
Yeah.
Something that's been with me all my life, but I never knew what it was before, and it took me many years of exploring and investigating before I could sort of understand, you know, where my beliefs lay.
Yeah.
So I'm still learning all about, you know, working with the cycles and doing rituals and things like that. And I intend to further study astrology in the near future because I feel like that's going to be quite important.
Yeah, and it's a full moon tonight, I believe.
It is, yes.
Has it already gone, or are we having a partial eclipse or something? This month's quite significant or something. We've had what was it you were saying?
We've had a solar eclipse and a lunar this month.
Lunar, is it November or is it crossing over to December? Do you know anything about this?
Yes, we had an eclipse on the last full moon. I know there is something significant happening at this time, but I can't actually remember the specifics. I don't want to say it in case I get it wrong.
No,
but
that's fine.
No, I think it's only a partial eclipse on the moon.
Is it a partial eclipse?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
Right, okay.
I know that there's a lot of planetary movements happening at the moment.
Right, okay. So when it comes to the Celtic and the Wicca, what difference is there exactly? Is there any specific differences? Obviously, you've got, you know, you've still got the Beltane and everything else and Samhain and all that lot. What else is different?
I think the main difference is really in how you follow it, the practice, if you like. To my knowledge, Wicca is a lot more structured.
Right, okay.
Although you do get people that practice solitary magic, you'll find a lot of people that prefer to work together in covens and doing very sort of, not regimented, but they like to do specific sort of ritualistic habits. I feel like the way that I do it is a lot more impulsive. I kind of go with how I feel rather than how things are suggested. Although I do obviously look at the information that's been shared around the world. I look at what's in books and what I find on the internet and speaking to other people. But I kind of pick up what feels right to me and then work with that.
And just out of curiosity, somebody's asked whether anyone's bathed in the new moon tonight. So is that something that you would do?
I think I would, but I'm a bit of a wimp and I get cold very easily.
Don't go sky club.
I'm certainly
tonight.
Not doing it tonight.
Oh dear. So and you're into the shamanistic stuff. What's that all about?
Yes, this is something I was introduced to this year. I must admit, in the past, I always thought of shamans as Native Americans, and I always thought that it was something that was, you know, nothing to do with me. It never seemed relevant to me, although it was, I was interested, I was curious. But my younger sister started getting into it and working with some people who are shamans, and she persuaded me to go to a retreat back in June this year.
Yeah.
And we worked with a lady called Barbara Meikle-John Free.
I know Barbara very well.
I'm sure lots of people are familiar with. And Flavia Kate Peters.
Yeah.
And we did a lot of shaman work that weekend. And it basically, it introduced me to something that felt completely natural. And I realised that there is a lot of history there for me to discover.
Yeah.
So it is something that I've decided to embark on. And so now I... as well as working as a witch, I look at things as a shaman because the two are very closely related.
Yeah.
In terms of honouring our ancestors and working with the seasons and working with nature as much as possible.
Reiki Debs is asking where the retreat is held.
Where the what, sorry?
Where the retreat is.
Oh, it's held in Derbyshire. At a place called Atlow Mill.
At where, sorry?
Atlow Mill.
Atlow Mill, right. Okay, I think
the details are on they're on Barbara's website.
Okay.
If you go on there,
anybody that knows Barbara, she can do with some healing at the moment.
Can she?
She's not doing too good.
Oh, bless her.
It's not widely known at the moment, but yeah. Something's returned that needs defeating again.
Oh, I see. So, well, it is now.
Right, it is amongst.
Yeah.
Our little group here, yeah.
But right, so we can send us some healing anyway. So you feel what? How did you feel that you needed? What drew you to all this pagan, witch, Celtic shamanism? What made you feel as though you needed to go down that road?
It's something that I feel like it's been with me all my life. As a child, I always felt that there was something out there that people weren't seeing or people weren't telling me.
Yeah.
And I always thought that I could see things that other people couldn't. I mean, I used to have imaginary friends, and as a child, obviously, when the adults told me that they were imaginary friends, that's what I believed. And I always read a lot of books as a child, so it kind of, to me, I always felt like it was all my imagination, these things that I would see and feel. As I got a bit older, I started to learn a little bit more about ghosts and spirits.
Yeah.
I developed a bit of a fascination about vampires and then moved on from there and started to mainly explore popular culture because that's what I was able to find at the time when I was younger.
Yeah.
Looking at films and reading books and whatever I could find. And eventually I began to understand that there were other ways of seeing the world rather than the traditional Christian upbringing that I had. And I started to understand that all of these imaginary friends that I had as a child might not have been so imaginary after all, and that it was all right to think that way.
Yeah.
It's a lot about perceptions. I've learned a lot about understanding my own mind, but also understanding my own feelings during the last few years.
Yeah. And like I said, to you earlier, that quote I found that I put on Facebook was... quite apt. I only found it today.
It was.
Let me just find it, just for those who didn't see it. Now, mind you, I've put quite a lot on today, I must admit. Let me just see where it is. 2 seconds. God, I have put a lot on today. Let me just...
Yeah, I mean, Deb was saying that once you get into one thing, it kind of leads into the other.
Yeah.
Because they're all pretty much connected.
That was it. I believe in everything until it's disproved. So I believe in fairies, the myths, dragons. It all exists, even if it's in your mind. Who's to say that dreams and nightmares aren't as real as the here and now? That was John Lennon who said that. And maybe he has got a point. Catherine obviously thinks so.
Well,
I do. I totally agree with that. Yeah.
I mean, John did go through a very spiritual phase in his life.
He did it later, didn't he? After the just at the end of the Beatles side of it.
Yeah,
so, do you feel as though you connect with spirit at all? Do you feel as though you're clairvoyant? intuitive medium?
Yes, I'm more of a sensitive than anything. I tend to feel my connection with spirit.
Mm-hmm.
I never used to consider myself a medium until I started to understand a bit more about how it worked when I was a ghost hunter.
Yeah.
Northwest Spirit Seekers. It sort of brought it out of me as I got more experienced on the events.
Yeah.
I learned to distinguish with when I was meeting with different spirit entities. So I can communicate with them when they come through. But I find that myself, I have a tendency to be I'm very defensive without realizing it, and I have to open myself up in order to allow the connection to come through.
Yeah.
But I will go into a place and, I'll get the sort of the cold shivers and the sensations of something there, and I'll know when there is somebody else there, and then I'll be able to focus on that and make the connection.
So how roughly would you, because obviously you do tarot work as well.
Yes, I do.
When it comes to readings and that, how do you work? Is it just basically one-to-one, face-to-face, or do you do telephone stuff, Skype stuff?
I do mainly face-to-face. I've been working at Mind, Body and Spirit events around the area. So I tend to just kind of do one-to-one, and it sort of just comes naturally then when I'm sitting with someone. I have done distance readings via email before now, which have been quite successful in terms of offering insights to the people that I read for.
Mm.
I was a little dubious about it at first, but once I tried it, I realised that, it will come naturally anyway, so
yeah.
What came through was all relevant for the people that I did it for.
And you're saying that you had a thing about vampires. Funny enough, I don't know whether you was listening to the show before you came on. We were talking about vampires, funny enough.
Oh, right.
Yeah, it was part of the observations or paranormal news, whatever you want to call it, about a place in... Well, the Austrian Times are telling everyone to be wary because of there's a possibility there's a vampire on the loose.
Right.
Of old, that is, so from old... So that was quite interesting, and us being to Brancastle this year, we're going back next year, so that was quite quite significant actually. But you say you're an author, you've written about these vampires and stuff, haven't you?
I have, yes.
So and was it the Radcliffe, is it? Or something?
Redcliffe Novels.
Do you want to just briefly tell us about all this?
I will, yep. The Redcliffe Novels are a series of novels set in a fictional town in Cornwall. I've called the town Redcliffe. It's loosely based on the real town of Lou and the village of Polperro.
Uh-huh.
Those are places that I've got my inspiration for in terms of the setting. The stories are told by our heroine, Jessica Stone, and she starts out in the first book, which is called Love Hurts. She starts as a very average independent woman. She's running a business with her best friend and she's quite happy and content.
Mm-hmm.
She then falls in love without really planning to, as we always do, and what transpires is that she eventually discovers that her lover is a vampire and his identical twin brother is a werewolf.
Oh God.
And she ends up sort of becoming embroiled in their adventures, if you like. The Mason brothers are police detectives, so their lives are never simple, regardless of the fact that they're paranormal creatures.
Yeah.
And so one thing leads to another, and Jessica becomes quite seriously involved. With lots of, there's quite a lot of violence toward the end of the first book.
Wow. Sounds like something out of The Grimm. That Grimm we've been watching. Have you seen that programme? Well, the new Grimm?
The brothers bit sounds a bit like Underworld.
It does, doesn't it?
There's two brothers in that. The original brothers, one was a vampire, one was a werewolf.
That series we watched, Grimm, that's quite good, I must admit. So so you felt, that you've had all this in you and you've put it out into a book or a few books.
Yes, I've got two books published, yeah.
Sounds like a good recipe for a film, though, doesn't it?
Well, I like to think so. I'm thinking now the Twilight Saga's over, there's room for another one.
Well, this is it. Nigel just said Mason Brothers, good name for the police.
Yeah, he's thinks there's a lot of Masons.
He thinks there's a lot of Masons. Masonic.
And to be honest, he's probably not far wrong. I was actually reading on one of your blogs about you've doing something for a competition about vampires in Blackpool.
Yeah, what was that about?
What was that one, sorry?
On your blog that you're doing for the writing thing, I said you got about 30,000 words at the moment.
Vampires in Blackpool. Over writing months, yes.
Yeah, something about Blackpool?
Yes, I've just written a vampire story set in Blackpool. Mm. There's an annual competition called National Novel Writing Month where during the month of November you have to write 50,000 words. And I did it for my first attempt last year, which was when I wrote my Redcliffe sequel, Love Kills.
Yeah.
And then this year I decided to take a break, so I've already written the third novel in the Redcliffe series. I took a break from Redcliffe and decided to do something a little bit different. Mm-hmm. So I had an idea for a vampire story in Blackpool, and I wanted it to become more of a horror story. But it sort of took me by surprise and ended as a bit of a romance as well, although it is pretty gruesome in places. So that will be going in for edits in the next few months, and I shall hopefully have that published next year.
And do you know much about elementals and stuff like that, by any chance?
A little bit, yes. Right.
Okay, can you just give us a bit of a history or a bit of a education about them at all? There's the fire and the wind and,
That's your four elements.
Yeah, your four elements and stuff. But there are some... evil little sprites, isn't there?
The ones you actually mentioned are used a lot in shamanism.
Yes.
Because our
lenders
a little bit of that.
Yeah, so you do use them in shamanism, don't you? As well as other things. Like Deb said, it all crosses over.
There's not really... The idea with shamanism and witchcraft as well, it's not about working with sort of good and evil. It's more about accepting the light and the dark side of life. So... it's accepting that everything has a cycle of events, and everything, you know, as people live their lives and grow old and pass on and then, you know, have children and carry on the family line, you get that happening everywhere around nature with the seasonal growth of the plant life and everything. And it's the same with elementals. You'll get different elemental energies that work with the seasons or the particular people, and that's what the shamans connect with. So this idea of the darker entities, like you say, you talk about sprites, you can get elementals that are perhaps not seen as particularly pleasant.
Yeah.
And they've come across mainly from folklore, you know, sort of the fairy tales, the old Grimm's fairy tales particularly. They were sort of twisted into morality tales and turned into what humans could really understand.
Yeah.
But I don't particularly think that there's any of them that are evil. It's just that they have their own place in the world and not necessarily in the world that we see as humans.
Right, well, guys in the chat room, I need you to suspend your disbelief for a moment and consider these real-life encounters with creatures from the land of make-believe. Do fairies, gnomes and goblins really exist? Most of us have grown up, as Catherine says, with timeless fairy tales of the Brothers Grimm and Hans Christian Andersen. There are wonderful stories populated by fairies, gnomes, trolls, goblins and other strange creatures that inhabit dark woods, foggy swamps, mystic meadows and mysterious mountains. There are also powerful stories that stay with us our entire lives because they tap into our primal fears of the unknown, creepy little archetypes of the human collective unconscious. But are these creatures only the stuff of folklore and imagination? Well, Catherine, and obviously John here, is about to tell us. What do you think, Catherine? Are they the stuff of nonsense or imagination?
They're the stuff of imagination, but only because they were there anyway.
Right.
It's just that some of us can see them and translate that from our imagination.
Right, okay. So what do you, when it comes to fairy folklore, what's your perception of it?
My perception of fairy folklore is that from what I understand so far from the research I've done, reading folk tales, mainly from Ireland I've begun reading, but what I see as the fairies is that they were just another kind of people. You know how we have the scientific evidence of Neanderthals and Homo sapiens and all sorts of different forms of humans, and some of them died out years ago. I believe it's the same with the fairies, that they are another race of people who lived many, many, you know, thousands of years ago. And for whatever reason, they, I wouldn't say they died out, but they sort of faded away. And at that point, they sort of confined themselves to the imagination, in terms of they continued their existence, but they concealed themselves from humans. And as the humans began to lose touch with the ancient energies of life, and as humans began to develop technology and develop machinery and things that they could make, take shortcuts with, essentially, that was when the fairies and maybe lots of other kind of people sort of faded into stories and folk tales and became part of the imagination.
Now, John, people around the world have claimed to have actually seen and even interacted with such beings in moments of stress and unfamiliarity. Are their minds merely recalling the fairy tales of their childhood, or are they really experiencing the real thing? What do you think?
From their perspective, they would be experiencing something actual.
It depends
how they view it, from technological points of view or a rural point of view.
See, many of the stories about fairies seem to be cautionary tales, showing that they can be very helpful as long as you stay in the right side of them. But farmers, unsurprisingly, are the beneficiaries of much of this help.
Can I just ask, Catherine, can you hear John?
Not very well.
Right, okay.
Speak up a little bit, John.
I'll bring this over so you can hear him. Go on. It's right. Talk in there as well.
Hello, Catherine.
Hello.
Yeah, I've done most of my researches on the Isle of Man regarding the fairy folk and all folklore, witchcraft and ghost lore type activity. What I come across in particular is people still generally believe in them. You know, when you get past the jokey type stuff, and people still, you know, respect them in certain aspects. And the older tales coming from the rural areas, people avoided certain areas at certain times of the day or evening and times of the year, not to interact with them in case, you know, with the little people or the fairish, or what they call them, was taking umbrage. And didn't actually call them by name because it was regarded as an insult. Have you come across that?
Yes. Yeah, I do find actually the more, even now, the more that I talk to people when it comes up in conversation, I'm surprised myself at how many people are quite happy to talk about fairies and elementals and to actually agree that they do exist and they know they're around there. There are more people in the world around us that are quite happy to live with these energies around them.
So the people could regard them as ghosts, depending on what they appear as, or supernatural creatures, which can appear as shapeshifters in several different guises, or the glamour, as they call it, which totally camouflages them. And, you know, like a force shield, if you like, in technology. They were always regarded as going away, but they never actually left, is the way I come across it.
Sorry, what was that?
The fairy folk were always regarded as leaving, going to Ireland or something like that, from certain points on the Isle of Man, but they never actually left. You know, like the UFO notes, which have never actually arrived.
Did you get that, Catherine?
Sorry, you were saying that the tales say that the fairies were supposed to have left, but they didn't leave the island.
Yeah, it appears that they've left, according to the tales, but they never actually did leave. But
they're
always on the point of leaving, and we know with modern technology, iron in particular, which and the belief and it sort of reduced them to nothing. Yeah. The religion coming in.
That's right. I mean, the way I see it is that they were with all the, you know, with all the different people that came together and different beliefs and, like you say, with religions. I just believe I believe personally that the fairies and a lot of other creatures just sort of, I wouldn't say faded, but they were sort of oppressed, I suppose, by the people that were following these new religions and were bringing in new ideals and new perceptions. And so I think that when you do get tales that say that they left the islands where they used to live, I think that's probably how it's been construed over time. But I certainly don't believe that they left anywhere that they originate from. I believe they're all around.
Yeah,
some people are willing to see them and some people aren't.
Yeah, I think if you're in the right frame of mind, at the right place, the right time, these things can be experienced. Although you may see them as ghosts today, described as small children on some occasions.
Yes, I think you're right there. I think that's how people tend to recognise things, because that's something perhaps that they're more familiar with.
Right, well, Steve's got a few questions for you, Catherine.
Yeah, I've got one's an observation. Nigel was saying that a newspaper photographer on Ilkley Moor saw a fairy run into a rock, and he managed to take the photos of the footprints. But Angel has asked, there's a couple of things she's asked. First of all, she said, what is fairy folklore? And can fairies help us like angels?
Again, it depends. It can be helpful or not so helpful, depending on how you approach them and what you actually do. Certain fairies are called boggarts. Used to be helpful around the farm. And if you left out milk or food, they allegedly help around the farm and do farm work. But if you approach with clothes, they regard as an insult and change the aspect of themselves, become more like a poltergeist, start wrecking the place and leave. You come across that, Catherine?
Sorry, the signal's breaking up a bit. I can't really hear that.
Yeah, you're very quiet this
morning. I'm trying to do my best here. I'm just saying, certain aspects of the fairies, if they regarded as someone's regarded as boggarts in the northwest and on the Isle of Man, and if they approached in the right manner, they'd be helpful around the farm, around the house. If you left food or water or milk out for them, but if you approached them with clothes to dress them, because they regard this as an insult, and then the bad aspect to come along, where they become like a poltergeist and start wrecking the farmhouse and machinery and the crops and stuff. Have you come across that at all?
I have heard stories like that, yes. And did somebody mention angels before as well? They were asking what the difference is working with the fairies and working with angels.
Yeah, that was Steve, yeah.
Angel was asking about
the fairy folklore.
Can they help us like angels, and what is fairy folklore?
Yeah.
She hasn't really come across it, although her mum does believe in fairies.
Do you want to take there, Catherine?
Yeah, I think that for me, the fairies are, they're a lot more of a sort of an earthy race of people. And yes, I think the fairies do tend to be more, perhaps more driven by ego, if you like. What I've come across in my studies and my experiences is that we have different energy vibrations that we operate on. So as humans, we operate on one level, and to me, fairies are on a different vibration, and angels are on another vibration again, and they're much higher sort of energy. So the way I see it is that yes, fairies do tend to accept gifts and would prefer to receive offerings, but they are very particular about what they prefer. I think because they are a lot closer to humans, you know, how we all have our own preferences and our own ideals and perceptions. I think that's exactly how the fairies are, which is why I think that they are, you know, just another race of people that that changed the way they appear in life. Whereas for angels, they are spirit forms, and you know they don't need the sort of practical things that the fairies might need. So there are people that work with angels because they feel that they connect a lot more with those on that sort of emotional level.
Yeah, there's a lot of stories I come across that the fairies folk are regarded as the dead, because they frequently found ancient sites, stone sites, stone circles, standing stones, and tumuli. And one particular story I came across when I was doing research is when they were building the Alaman Electric Railway, it passed through a settlement called Baldreen, and the railway had to cut through a tumuli, a kist, where it was a burial site, and it cut behind a school building. And just after that happened, the people described it as fairies coming into the building and interacting with the children and the people, and they come in every night, and it doesn't exactly describe what happened, but you can see the connection between the dead or ancestors and the fairy folk themselves. You got that?
So they're sort of coming back. They are sort of in between ghosts and people, I suppose, aren't they, really? I think that's how a lot of humans are interpreting them when they see the fairies.
Mm. There's also similar ones where they've sort of imitated human behaviours, such as the trooping fairies, where they suddenly appear in a particular area as maybe red lights, and appear to march like troops back and forward. And then there's also they battle with each other, different types, or maybe different troops. They engage in like human warfare. Have you heard across that?
I've not heard of that. No, it's not something I've not come across those sorts of stories. I've heard the stories of fairies that can be very playful and that can interact with people, particularly with children.
Mm.
You know, with fun and games and playing tricks on people and tricks on animals,
yeah.
But not in a malicious way. And I've heard of the stories of changelings as well.
Yeah,
changelings, particularly on the island, seem to be a very specific type of thing. Also, the houses were built, if they built across fairy lines, or the lines of the dead, if you want to call it that, the house would engage on a certain time of the year when the fairies are marching. The house would have poltergeist activity all the way through it till the fairies had passed through. And certain houses would have slots built in the top of the house to let the fairies pass through, or they'd have a corner taken off. Now, when I was in Baldreen, I noticed the post office had a corner shaved off it. For no particular reason, but, you know, saving building material. And for it backed right onto an ancient tumuli with standing stones. If they want to go along with the ley line sort of theory, or lines of connection, that connected with another large tumulus or earthwork, no more than, I would say, half a mile away on top of the hill. Have you come across that one?
No, I haven't actually. That sounds quite interesting.
It's more prevalent in the Irish tales, the trooping fairies and on the lines through the houses. Also across the fields, the trees take up a certain line. There's also gaps in the hedges and gaps in the field walls to let the fairies through. Apparently, again, to do with the lines of the dead and shamanism and mystery tunnels. It all seems to have a connection.
Well, Steve's got some more questions for you, Cass.
Yeah, Derry was saying that he's got a fairy ring in his garden.
Yeah.
What is to do with
what is a fairy ring, Catherine?
A fairy ring in the garden?
Mm-hmm.
It's, to my knowledge, it's a place that you set out in your garden to invite the fairies to come and play.
Ah.
So it's your way of giving an offering. You can go and leave your gifts for the fairies in the ring.
Right.
And the idea is that they come and collect the offerings and in turn will do the favours that you ask of them if they agree.
Right.
And if you're very lucky, they might show themselves to you as well.
Right.
They tend to be mushrooms, don't they?
Yeah, sometimes.
Mushrooms do warm, wet weather. They do get the circle of mushrooms, and there's lots of them, especially where I am, up and down the central reservation of a dual carriageway. You come across that a lot, Catherine?
I couldn't hear that. What was that one? Sorry.
The mushrooms in a circle. There's plenty of them by me on a dual carriageway, right in the centre of the traffic. And that's not particularly sort of mystical at all.
I don't know about whispering Neil Monnelly. I think we've got whispering John Hall.
Whispering, yeah. I have to shout a bit louder.
But another thing that's been mentioned in the chat room is gnomes. Reiki Debs has been told, or she feels that they are earth elements. Gnomes are earth elementals. Could this be why that people adorn them in their gardens? What do you reckon, Catherine?
Yeah, the gnomes are they are the worker bees, if you like. They're the ones that they're associated with mining and working with the land, and they're very serious creatures.
Yeah.
So yes, I think that is why people like to have them in the garden, because the idea is that they help you to take care of your garden, to nurture it in the right way, and to protect it as well.
What I did was, whilst we were calling you, I played a clip from Hook, Peter Pan, where Tinkerbell says, you know, say it, Mary, Peter, that he believes in fairies. And she says, I'll be with you just as you're waking up, you know, in that dream area. Do you feel as though a lot come to us in dream areas, Catherine?
I think so, yes. I mean, I used to get a lot of things in dreams, and obviously I used to think that it was just my imagination, and then I'm starting to realise now that more and more things are maybe not just my imagination, but that's the easiest time to come through, because when your body's in that relaxed state, you're open to receiving those kind of messages.
Mm. And you've written short stories of these, haven't you? Is these the short stories you've written about fairies and stuff?
No, I haven't, no.
Oh, have you not written about fairies?
No, I probably will in the future, but at the moment most of my stories just involve vampires and shapeshifters.
Had you any plans to write about fairies?
I have, yes.
Oh, good. Either that or I just channeled that.
I was going to say, she does now.
You have plans to write about it? Are you there?
Yeah.
You have plans to write about it.
Yeah, but I've got some plans to develop some stories involving fairies and elementals in the future, yes.
Right. And they can be mischievous, Deb says. Very mischievous.
Yeah.
Are they always mushroom rings? Can they not be flowers?
Are they always mushroom rings?
They're daisies.
Can they be daisy rings?
I've quite often seen that.
We've seen daisy circles. Would you say that was probably the more familiar for these fairy rings?
Yeah, I'd say so.
Mm.
I always associate them with fairies.
Yeah, they're quite sprightly, for want of a word. So you've done your Redcliffe novels, which I'm quite surprised at, really, that you haven't written anything, because Paul Perro, there's a shop down there called Joan the Wad. Have you ever been to it?
I probably have, to be honest. It's been a few years since I went down there.
Right, well, it is actually...
The old Pixies.
Yeah, it used to be an online... Well, there is an online shop called Joan the Wad. Mind you, from what I saw on the news lately, they were
a bit wet
down there. But it's a Pixie shop. You know, the Pisky, Cornwall Pisky traditional
thing? Oh, yes, yeah.
Yeah, So I used to have a thing about the Piskies when I was young, because we always used to go to Cornwall for a holiday, you know. So maybe that's why you've picked Cornwall, because it is quite
Yeah, I think
we go down there, and as soon as we hit that A39 into St Austell, it just changes, you know. And
it's a very energetic land.
Yeah.
A lot of energy.
It is a very magical county, I find, yeah.
Yeah, and as I say, Celtic and what have you. Mm. But yeah,
it's got all the Arthurian tradition.
The old Arthur tradition.
And numerous standing stones, stone circles.
Yeah.
Which have, and of course, the West Towns up on the moors.
Mm.
Which are all very, very fascinating, you know, and the mists and the ghosts.
It's got everything, really, yeah. If you think about it, because you've got your big cats, you know, you've got your cryptozoology, you've got your ghosts, you've got your pixies and fairies.
You've got St Michael's Glen.
You know, you've got...
St Michael's Mount. Yeah.
You know, St Michael's Mount. You've got, was it St Necklin or whatever
it
is?
Glen,
St St Necklin Glen, which they're up for selling and trying to save.
But
yeah, but you know, and it's got everything there, wouldn't you say, Catherine?
It has, yes.
Has it got vampires? Well, it has now.
It has now, yeah.
Nigel, has any views on old hags?
Old hags? Well, there's one for you. Have you got any old hags lurking about, Catherine?
No, I haven't, not yet.
I have, but I got rid of her. I think I must have put a spell on her. What about you, John? You got any old hags in your closet?
Oh, well, that's it. Apparently, it's a source of a dream state where something called the old hag comes and rests on your chest in the middle of a dream.
Is it?
But it's more than a dream, because you source it in between the waking state and dreaming state, and it takes on almost a physical reality, which is can be very frightening.
Yeah, I bet.
I suffer with a condition called sleep apnea.
Yeah.
And I tend to get, you know, I did get these things quite a lot, but I tend to block it off now. I've got some sort of treatment for it.
Yeah.
But, funny enough, when I went to Cornwall, I started getting this quite a long time ago. I was staying on a campsite, and it was very near Trencombe Hill and a standing stone, and it was just after I'd been staying there, and it was middle of a thunderstorm. I went down, so must have been wide open to all this stuff going on.
Yeah.
You know, and then I had these nightmares just plagued me for time after time, till I managed to get a handle on it and managed to block it.
Mm.
I've had to do some extensive research to find out these things. You know, I might have a passing interest, but I had to really go into it to try and find out how to block.
Yeah.
Certain, you know.
Yeah.
But it definitely the old hag.
Had that.
Yeah. You had something similar, Catherine?
Yeah, well, somebody quite close to me experienced it a few times. And when we did some research into it, one of the connections we found there was slightly more scientific, but it was suggesting that the hag syndrome was sometimes a result of a form of jet lag when you've been travelling for a fair distance.
Yeah.
But I couldn't really get my head around that, in all honesty, how you can, you know, manifest a solid presence that can sort of cause your body to be paralysed in a way, and then just disappear. It just didn't make any sense to me.
Well, that's it. It was almost, you know, it's vampire-y in a
yeah.
way. Yeah, it just draws your energy completely.
Well, if my old hag turned up here and sat on me, I don't think I'd survive.
there's a couple of things going on there. In the chat room, initially they said it was sleep paralysis or hypnotic dreaming.
Yeah. Psychological conditions.
Obviously, the one to what you said, there's a couple of people in here that suffer from the same thing.
Yeah.
Nigel said, this sleep paralysis told him what he'd be doing in 2 days, and after she visited me, she stunk of death.
Bloody
yeah, it is extreme. It can be really extreme. Fortunately for me, it doesn't happen a lot now.
So, Catherine, the occult side, do you deal with the occult side at all?
Yes, I do.
Because we've now got Andy707 in the chat room. So, what kind of occult bit do you actually deal with?
Well, it's more of an interest, really. I mean, to me, occult is... the I want to say the darker side of the paranormal, but not necessarily the kind of the bad side that people would associate it with.
Yeah.
The occult is more things that, well, it's pretty much everything that we've already talked about. It's things that people maybe don't understand or are afraid of because it's something unfamiliar to them.
Yeah, because when you think of occult, I must admit, Andy wants to come in and talk about this. I thought of black witches, black magic, the devil, Satan, bow down before me and get behind me and whatever, jump on your back, you know what I mean? Sort of like, you know, dancing around naked on the fire and whatever, you know. I did think about all that because I did touch on it when I was younger, the black magic side, but there's more to it than that. No, I've not seen too many films, but there used to be a cult down in Kent when I was younger. So, and they used to deal with all that, but that was more the black magic side. You know what I mean? Mm. So, yeah.
Deb says religion is a cult.
Oh yeah, it is. But yeah, no, we're saying occult. We're talking here. Just means hidden, right? So, what kind of occult would you say you was? It was more white magic, so to speak, is it?
Well, yeah, I mean, I wouldn't say that I practice either dark or white magic because, like I say, it's all about the duality. It's about working with what we need to do.
Hmm.
I've been exploring what I call my shadow side, looking into the shamanism.
Yeah.
And it's just looking at aspects of the self that are maybe not quite so pleasant, you know, your own ideas, your own beliefs.
Hmm.
And it's when you start to look into yourself and think, where did that come from? Why do I believe this? Why do I feel that about certain people?
Yeah.
And why, you know, and you might sort of say, why do I so readily accept what this person tells me?
Yeah.
Not the other. And it's that idea of turning different energies into different forms. So, I mean, like you mentioned before, you know, you think of occult as the idea of working with dark magic or working with Satan. Well, those are really just constructs that have been built up by big religious institutions over the years, really just to act as a, you know, as a warning, as a cautionary tale to people that might be interested,
mm-hmm.
because they wanted to stop people from, you know, going back to their heritage and looking back, and they wanted people to live a certain way and behave in a certain way. So the occult really is just looking beyond what we've been conditioned to believe and exploring perhaps what we used to do many, many thousands of years ago.
Yeah, and you said you're talking about, I hope I pronounced this right, Jungian archetypes or the shadow.
Does that sound right?
What's that one, sorry?
And you said you're talking about Jungian or Jungian archetypes or the shadow.
For the psychoanalysis side of it.
Yeah.
Definitely, yeah, it's what makes us tick, essentially. Yeah.
A lot of the Jungian archetypes could be like the white lady, the monk character, certain, you know, animal, human, hybrids, and various types of fairy various ghosts even. They take on this certain aspects which seem to repeat worldwide in different cultures.
Well, most places seem to have a grey lady for some reason.
Yeah, a grey lady, a green lady, a white lady.
Oh, yeah, I've got one of them coming up later.
The typical cowl monk.
And, for Nigel, the middle of nowhere seems to have a blue lady.
Yes, it does, yeah. So you're also into mythology. So what mythology are you actually in? Because I do like the Jason and the Argonauts Greek mythology. So what mythology are you into, Catherine?
At the moment, I'm exploring the Celtic mythology.
Uh-huh.
The old, you know, the gods and goddesses of the ancient times. And I'm also looking into Greek and Egyptian mythology a bit as well. I've got an interest in those.
Yes, I do like the Greek, you know, the Zeus and Hera and all that lot. But when you say Celtic, can you give a few names so we know whereabouts you're looking at?
Yeah, one of the, probably one of the main energies that people might recognise is Brigid. She's sometimes known as Brigid, and she is one of the goddesses of Beltane. When the season turns to Easter, she comes forward as an energy for rebirth and, you know, children and new growth. I think she's quite a familiar figure for people.
Yeah.
turns out to be Saint Bride as well.
Saint Bride.
Yeah. That's it. Yes. Yeah.
And then, a lot of the old gods and sites and everything were Christianized. Mm. They occupied churches occupied, in particular ancient sites, stone sites, tumuli. They put their own. The people kept worshiping there, so they put their own religion on top of it. Everything's built on something else.
Mm.
So, yeah, it's still there, but it's got the modern veneer over the top of it.
Yeah.
That's it. That's what I'm looking at the moment. I'm looking, you know, beyond what I was raised to believe in and where it came from.
Yeah. I think that's what everyone needs to do, really, is to look underneath, if you know what I mean, what we've been taught, to see what the realistic side of it is. Like Derry D just said in his cemetery, 90% of the stone markers have Masonic symbols. You know, it does, you know, you have to find out what the hell that's all about, don't you, when it comes to symbols and what area you're going in, if you're being taught one thing.
A lot of the older churches, the Masons used to build the church, used to incorporate ancient things into the church, and you wouldn't recognise it unless you knew what was about. They used to incorporate the green man into the cornices and into the bosses, and also into the exterior. Mm. And the gargoyles, they were the Christian devils to keep out the pagan devils, apparently. You know, they were stronger magic, in other words.
Is this also where you get your inspiration for your designs on your craft work that you do, the wands and things? I did try and have a look on one of your sites, but there's no pictures there, so I couldn't have a look.
Yeah, your jewellery and wands and stuff, is that where you get your creativity from?
Yeah, it is. I've been doing bead jewellery for a few years now. That I tend to work more with the sort of colours and incorporating bright colours into my jewellery. Making wands and staffs is something I'm just kind of getting into now. I'm sort of dabbling in it, if you like. And yes, it's definitely come about as a result of my experiences over the last 12 months. I just sort of feel that different things come along at different times.
Mm.
And making those was something that I felt I had to do.
Because you've got quite a few sites, haven't you, on your...
Yeah.
Do you want to go through them briefly, what they are and what they're for?
Yes, my...
You can remember them.
I'll probably give you the main sites. My author site is www.catherine-green.co.uk, and that's where you can get details about the Redcliffe novels, and there's also a free short story on that website, which is a werewolf story set in Redcliffe.
Right.
And my more spiritual website is www.spirit-sisters.co.uk. That one came up a couple of years ago when myself and my younger sister began to work together. Initially, we were looking at, we were doing the ghost hunting and the tarot reading, and then we started to explore shamanism and moving off into different areas. So it's kind of evolving as we're evolving, if you like, that website. But we update that with information about what we're doing and where we're going for anybody who's interested.
And you've got something coming up this weekend, haven't you?
I have, yes. I've got two Mind, Body and Spirit fairs this weekend.
Uh-huh.
One is in Whitchurch on Saturday at the Town Hall. And the other one is in Alderley Edge on Sunday at the Festival Hall. Both of those events are on from 10 in the morning until 5 in the afternoon. And at the Alderley Edge event on Sunday, we're having a fairy and angel grotto as well.
Sounds good. I'm going to that, actually, because I've got to go and meet, what was her name again? Alison Wynne Ryder. She's on there as well.
Oh, right, yes.
So
yeah.
I'll be saying hello if I'm awake.
Hopefully.
I might be doing an invest on Saturday. We're planned to, but it depends what the weather's like up there. So, because you do this tarot. What tarot pack do you use? What? Because there's so many out there. Is it the Celtic ones you use?
The main tarot deck I use at the moment is the Gilded Tarot.
Uh-huh.
Which the It's designed by an Italian, and the images to me are very passionate, very, very rich colours, and very evocative of emotions, which is why I like to work with them. I kind of like to bring out what people are locking away inside.
Yeah, yeah, I bet it.
It's coincidence that I mentioned the Blue Lady, because he saw one at Roslyn.
Did he?
In the woods outside the Roslyn Chapel.
The Roslyn Chapel's specifically marked with all kinds of weird and unusual stuff inside the church.
Yeah.
Some say it's a connection with something like Nigel's
portal.
Some people, yeah.
Well, he's also said that they have a giant swastika built into the floor of their local chapel, which is very pagan, which, for those of you who are thinking swastika, if I remember rightly, it's the opposite way to the Germans having it.
Yeah, it's the opposite to
the
Nazis.
Yeah, the Nazis.
Yeah, the sun symbol, it says.
It was one of the early Christian symbols.
Yes, it was.
I dare say it went further back than that. But
yeah.
The early Christians did use it.
You know, but because if you look at it, it's meant to be the opposite way to what the High Hitler would have had. Similar to the Antikorana, if I've pronounced that right too, said Reiki Debs. Antikorana, something like that. So is there any more questions before we send Catherine on her way? If there is, please come through now. I saw something about, John says something about, he walked through a cemetery and most of the angels had no heads.
All the angels' heads were missing.
Yeah, probably somebody's been throwing something at them and knocked them off now in our luck.
You said he asked a question, but I missed it.
I think that's what it was. Has anybody else got any more questions for Catherine before we send her on her way, which we've enjoyed this evening? I'll be honest with you, Catherine, it's been enlightening.
Just one more for you, Catherine.
Yes, I've enjoyed it too. Thank you for having me.
That's all right. John's got one for you.
Have you heard of a novel called The Weird Stone of Brisingamen?
I haven't, no.
It's based around Alderley Edge, and it uses all the topographical features, and it features it's really a child story, but it's got all the elements of the pagan world, you know, fairies, goblins, gnomes, use of the caves, and area beyond. It's worth checking out.
Yes, I will do.
I can't remember the name of the author now, but he also wrote the Owl Story and several other pagan witch type novels around Cheshire, basically.
Yeah. What was that book called again?
The Weird Stone of Brisingamen.
The Weird Stone of Brisingamen. I asked if anyone had any questions. All I got was yes, yes, and yes. But they're not typing them. But apart from this weekend, is there anything else people can get you apart from your websites? Is there any any tarot readings that you do apart from at the MBSs?
I can do personal tarot readings if people are interested. They can contact me via the Spirit Sisters website.
Spirit Sisters.
I can do them via Skype, new telephone,
right.
And my email address is on there as well. So
Okay.
Look at the site.
Carry on.
If people tend to use Twitter,
mm-hmm.
I'm quite active on there. My username on Twitter is Spooky Mrs. Green.
All right.
So that will update everything that I'm doing as and when. I tend to update that every day. So if anybody's interested, they can follow me on Twitter and they'll soon keep up to date with what's happening.
Right. Andy707 says, what are your... I think he asked this before, but with somebody else who is an author. What are your publishers like? Are they looking for new writ words? Writ words?
For new what, sorry?
Writ words? I think it means writers.
Yeah.
Are they looking for new writers?
Yes, they are. The publisher I work with are called Mirador.
Mirador. Okay, there you go.
And they're based in Somerset.
Right.
And yes, they're always keen to discover new writers. So if anybody does want to submit something to them, just check out the Mirador Publishing website.
Is that Mirador as in a door that looks like a mirror? Or is it?
It's,
can you spell it?
Yeah, it's spelled M-I-R.
Yeah.
M-I-R-A-D-O-R.
Mira, right. M-I-R-A-D-O-R.
Yeah.
There you go, guys. That's who she is. And going back to Cornwall, when you say Redcliffe, I actually thought you was going to say Redruth, because that's actually,
yes.
That's actually in Cornwall as well, near Truro, isn't it?
Mm,
yeah. But you said my favourite place, Paul Perro. And what was the other one?
Lou,
yeah, lovely places they are, aren't they? We love Lou and Paul Perro, don't we?
So, we do.
And the little, what I call pixie houses all around, but they're not, they're actually old chimneys, aren't they?
They're part of the tin mines.
Are they? So, yeah.
And they're back in action, some of them, because tin's extremely, in you know, the current climate, it's wanted for producing copper, amongst other things, or you know, combinations for the computer and mobile phone technology.
Right, so this MBS you're at this week, if anyone wants to come down and have a reading with you, what are they looking at to pay per reading?
I do a full tarot reading for £30, and that includes tarot cards and oracle cards. The oracle cards I tend to use sort of close off the reading at the end. They'll just summarise what we discussed during the reading.
Yeah.
And I've got different decks of oracle cards. I've got some mermaid ones that I'm working with at the moment, and I've got some angel oracle cards as well. So I shall have them all with me on the day.
Right, okay. And how long does a tarot reading last for?
Usually about half an hour to 40 minutes. It just depends on what comes up. I mean, you never know what to expect, so... can't really put a time on them.
And can you give us your Twitter name again?
Yes, I can. It's at Spooky Mrs. Green.
Spooky Mrs. Green.
Yeah, at Spooky Mrs. Green.
Yeah, at Spooky Mrs. Green. There you go. So so there you go. So it's just Mrs. Green, basically, with the at in front. And yes, my chat keeps freezing. It's live stream. You can go to live stream direct and use their chat if you want. That might be a bit better. I think that's what Doc Savage does. Okay.
Are you putting a link to Catherine's website on your site?
I will be doing so, yes. Mm. We will be putting the links on there, so that's not a problem. Yep, that's it. At Spooky Mrs. Green. So, right, okay. Well, thanks a lot, Catherine. And hopefully, if I'm awake, I'll see you on Sunday.
Brilliant, yes. And before I go, I'll just sort of, I will just say... I'm afraid I've got no internet access at the moment. I don't know if I was going to get the connection tonight for Skype, but we've got a fault in our server, so I'm not able to go on the chat rooms, but I will be on my websites as soon as I can if anybody does want to contact me.
Well, thank you very much.
I will be getting mobile emails, so if anyone does want to contact me, they can do.
Okay. Well, thanks very much, Catherine. It's been great, and hopefully we'll get you back on the show again sometime next year, and if we survive. And we can catch up with you and see what you've been doing and what other new books you've got.
Brilliant. Thank you very much for having me.
Okay. But as I say, if you do get anything else published, just give us an email or something, and we'll be happy to mention it on the show.
Thank you.
All right, beloved. No. So take care. Thanks, and Catherine. Thanks again. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.
Night, Catherine.
Good night. Well, that was Catherine. And nice lady, wasn't she?
Good.
So, and that was basically everything she does. It was quite interesting, wasn't it?
Yeah.
So, but we'll come back to that in a minute. So what do you reckon, guys? I'll leave you to think about it. And... you know, do they have a basis for reality? Is the idea too crazy to even consider? And like I said before, unsurprisingly, farmers do actually have beneficiaries of much of their help, apparently, when it comes to their stuff. You missed the start, then you'll have to listen back again. I'm not starting again, Andy. And on the subject of occult, a certain young man is coming on in a couple of weeks' time, and basically, they will be talking about the occult, as I said, and we can find out just what is so much different to Hollywood, because he seems to think I've looked at too many films, And unfortunately, I can't go to Essex to do the show live there, which is a shame.
No, we can't yet because petrol's a bit on the prices. But it's that was like I was saying, that was quite interesting. There's a lot
it
of
was.
Things there you don't normally think,
no.
think about.
No, this
talk
is
about.
It. And while we was there, we had a few people come in. We had Andy 707 popped. East joined us. Stuart joined us from Simply Ghost. I don't know if he's still there.
When Neil came in for a while.
Yeah, I know. Perhaps he's not keen on fairies, and we're not talking about the feathered variety. but yeah. So maybe
that,
he's Skype.
I think that he was coming through his phone. Wasn't he?
I'm not sure. Either that or he's. Oh, he is there! Ha ha ha! I knew I'd get a rise out of him. But I don't know. But yeah, so what we're going to do is we're going to take a short break and we're going to go through to the paranormal events for you.
We've got all the news right here. Don't go away.
On the 30th of the 11th, Sixth Sense PR events are off the Morgan Castle in Port Talbot. And on the 1st of the 12th, Ghost Hunt with GC UK at the Guildhall in York. And on the 7th of the 12th, there's a psychic evening at the Lee Valley Millennium Centre in Liverpool. On the 15th of the 12th, Ghost Hunt with the Haunting Team at the Four Crosses Pub in Cannock. And on the 29th of the 12th, DI Paranormal UK are going to the London Dungeons in London.
And for information on these events and many more, go to paranormaleventsforyou.com.
So check out the one-stop paranormal directory for more investigations and events available now. Paranormaleventsforyou.com also offers banner advertising for only £10 per year. See our website for more details. Paranormaleventsforyou.com, your one-stop paranormal directory.
Well, welcome back to the show. And if you're not doing anything, as you probably would have heard, on the 7th of December, Neil Munnerly is at the Lee Valley Millennium Centre in Liverpool. So he'll be demonstrating his mediumship as a psychic medium. It's his homecoming show before Christmas.
Yeah, his last show.
Yep, on his psychic tour of 2012. Not that he's been very far.
The more the merrier.
Yes, the more the merrier.
Well, he has been very busy with his moving and everything.
He has, with his moving and stuff like that. I am still there then. So, so they're the events for this week. The Paranormal Events for You is up and running. Okay, so if you have got any events, you can put them on there. Don't forget, do not leave your prices. We just want a link to your website so they can get more information. So just a brief bit would be fine. So, but
that's why it's nearly all up.
Yeah, we're getting there. So, I'll let you know shortly who we've got coming up next week. But there's still a bit of way to go yet. We've still got our guest here, John Hall, and he's going to be talking to us in a minute. Concerning Andy 707, I will call you if I've got your number, but you probably have to give it to me again. And then we'll have a chat on what we'd like you to talk about, if that's okay. All right.
Hollywood.
Hollywood. Yeah. Yeah. So we'll talk all about that a bit later. And
maybe we can
you should have. I'll have to check with my thingy.
Maybe we can pick the bones out of from what Hollywood.
Yeah.
What
well, this is be. It. You know, when it comes to the occult, okay, I was brought up on Dennis Wheatley. I have my Bible sitting in the bookshelf somewhere.
No
the Devil and All His Works.
No,
so, you know, no better man to think about or to read about. But that was a good book, though, because it goes through all of it, doesn't it? The paganism, the numerology, it goes through witch, you know, Satanism, black magic. It goes through
all stuff.
All stuff. Yeah. Yeah. So. Yeah.
I mean, he even tells a story on there of a
very long suspension bridge. Suspension bridge across this big canyon.
Yeah.
That was actually built before Christ.
Really?
It's like, how the hell did they get it there?
God. But
and it's still used today. Still using it.
Andy, talk about the satanic politicians. Has anyone seen my website? There's a thing on there where it says, there's a picture of Parliament and it says, do you really want to delete these
650
cheating, I think it is, or something like that, bar stewards, you know, and it's quite funny actually. Well, it was at the time. My main area is of interest, it's medieval grimoires. You go there. We will have a little bit of the grimoires. That's not a problem. So, hello, Vicky.
Lamp of Thoth.
Have you heard of it? He has.
Why does that sound familiar?
Whatever you talk about, I'm sure it'd be interesting and a little bit of an insight for everyone. Right, well, what I'm going to do now, before we get back on to John, I'm going to talk about our next haunted series. Okay?
Yeah.
We're into the next haunted series. Throw that down there.
Where are we going?
We're going to Lincoln. Yeah.
I won't bother turning my mic back on.
Why? Was it not on?
No.
Oh, have you not got a switch?
Yeah, I turned it off and I went downstairs.
Oh, right, okay. So you weren't talking in it, was you?
No.
Let me just take a drink. Cheers, everyone. Coke. Pepsi, actually. God, that's cold. Right, we're going to Lincoln. Anyone from the Lincoln area, may I ask? Okay, if you visit the Castle Hill Club, be sure to keep an eye out for who is lurking behind you at all times. Although there are several ghosts who are said to haunt the building, perhaps the most infamous is the Bottom Pincher. Although this phantom is never seen, it is said to lie in wait until an innocent bystander has their back turned, particularly around the bar area of the club, then strike with a cheeky pinch of the bum. The spectre is apparently not bothered whether it's his victim is male or female, or it's, we don't know if it's a male or a female anyway, as long as they have a bottom, they will pinch. Another less famous ghost in the building is said to be that of William Marwood, who was the former hangman in Lincoln Castle, just across the square. He is not said to inhabit the building, merely to visit sometimes, as he would have done in his hanging days when the Castle Hill Club was a pub. He has apparently been seen looking out of the room where he used to stay, which is a window on the east side of the building. Although there are recordings of a building on the site of the Castle Club right back to early 1640, it is very likely that this building or a different one was situated in the location for hundreds of years before, because of the situation of the plot between the castle and the cathedral. Where was I? The earliest records of the building as it is today were to the Black Boy Inn, a pub, in a document dated 1745, most of the building had been changed over the years, particularly after the 1700s, but a few of the original features remain the same, such as a chimney stack in the hall of the building. The building remained a pub until 1923, when it was closed down, and little has changed in its appearance to this day. When it was shut down, some of the former regulars of the pub got together and reopened it, as it is known today, the Castle Hill Club. There were some refurbishments throughout the building during the mid-1960s, and in the 90s the club became a members-owned, which is still remained today. In the shadow of Lincoln Cathedral, you will find this reputed haunted restaurant, set in what once was a 12th century house. The 16th century inn, the Black Horse, now is a restaurant situated on Bardney Road, Lincoln, has a blurry-faced phantom clothed in a long grey dress. The grey lady, who has also been sighted in the bedrooms and on the stairs and landing, and on the first floor by staff when When seen, she is said to disappear through a brick wall. So scary is her appearance that a cleaner working at the premises, who witnessed the apparition, fled and never returned. The grey lady has also been spotted outside the restaurant, standing as if waiting for somebody. During the pub renovations, workmen experienced a host of unexplained activity whilst working in this pub, such as hearing footsteps, walking across unoccupied parts of the building, tools disappearing, then reappearing in different locations around the premises, lights switching themselves on when there was no electricity. If you are in Lincoln, visit the castle, the cathedral and the old town square, but don't miss out on the Black Horse Chambers. Like the ghost, make it one of your usual haunts. Also worth a look is Brown's Pie Shop. This was visited by Ian McKellar twice during his week-long visit. The Stale and Ale pie is legendary and portions are quite massive. But be warned though, there is a ghost here, a little boy called Humphrey. If you are sitting in the basement area, make sure to acknowledge him because he does cause mischief. He occasionally puts in an appearance running around the shop. A young girl is also said to haunt the building, as is the sound of money being counted. I'd like to count some money at the moment. My money, that is. Right, and lastly, Lincoln Castle has several towers, one called Cobb Hall. A defensive tower built in the 13th century, Cobb Hall is a horseshoe-shaped building at the northeast corner, which served as the castle prison for many centuries. The county gallows were moved there in 1817, and its roof was used for public hangings until 1868. As with the other nearby towers, an invisible presence tries to force visitors back down the stairs, but this horrid ghost has a habit of picking on children. Fortunately, on each reported occasion, a parent has been on hand to prevent their child being shoved down the hard stone steps. One parent actually saw the apparition of an old woman dressed in black. They apparently caused this malicious behaviour. Saved only by her father's quick reflexes, he then watched the woman disappear from view. So that's Haunted Lincoln, or some of it. There's quite a few bits and pieces in Lincoln, but they're just a few. So that was Haunted Lincoln. Yeah, the lawn. It's the only trouble with the lawn is you can only get it on a Friday. Or a Sunday or something. Very good. Yeah, I bet it's very good as well. Right, well...
And anyway, funny is that song about Mr. Blobby.
Mr. Blobby.
And about crinkly bottom.
Oh, dear. Right, well, that's finishing this week as well. The crinkly bottom thing. What I call crinkly bottom. Right, well, if you've been on the KTPF on Facebook, you would have seen that we have, or will be, they're winging their way in the post, donated.
Can I just ask, have you got your teeth in?
No.
Because Andy says put them in.
Shut up, Andy, cheeky booger. Right, we have had donated a family ticket to Speak Hall in Liverpool, valid until the 9th of December. And we were asking for anyone to tell us the name of the White Lady of Speak House, who is said to have thrown her baby out of the tapestry window and then killed herself after finding out that her husband had been having affairs. We asked people to email us at admin@ktpf.co.uk today. And we had one email come through. And so that person has won. Because there's only one email come through. I'll just double check, make sure we haven't had any more. So Speak Hall, what do you know about Speak Hall, John?
I go there a lot, actually, because I'm in a cycle club, and it always ends up at Speak Hall if you do a certain ride. It's an interesting property. The ghost story, so I've heard, it, there's a... Well, it's not what it appears to be. from what I come across, it's an interesting aside. None of the guides or anything appear to, they mention it, but it's not sort of really played on as such, and it doesn't appear to be. Well, I think there's one other ghostly-like incident in another part of the hall, a large room, and they opened up the loft or attic area just a few years back. But again, and there's no reported activity or anything as such. A lot of the staff go around dressed in Elizabethan costume around the grounds, certain times of the year.
Mm-hmm.
Attract all extra customers, you might say. You might make it a bit more interesting for the people.
Yeah.
If you've never been to Speak Hall, you have to pay to get in the grounds.
Yes.
And it's extra to go around the hall.
Yes, I noticed that. That's what I put on there, actually. It's I checked it out. It's £8.10 for adults, £4 for children, and £4.95 for adults, and £2.90 for children to go around the gardens only. But you have to pay extra on top to go to the gardens, apparently. So I don't know whether it incorporates the gardens or not.
If you pay to go in the hall, that includes the gardens, but it can just go around the gardens themselves, but apparently it doesn't include going into the calf.
No.
You'd have to pay to go through.
Yes.
And sit and have a cup of tea in the calf.
Yes, definitely. But Nigel was being funny. He said, "Speak, John Hall."
Speak, yeah. Well, the standing running joke was, where do you send a budgie to talk and you send him to speak, don't you?
Oh, dear. So, you're a Fortean researcher, okay? That's what they call you.
which means
he didn't know it until the other week.
Which means you're into all things pertaining to the extraordinary, strange phenomena and happenings, correct?
Yeah, anything strange and weird and wonderful.
So what have you found weird and wonderful and what have you?
Thought about putting you on the spot, John.
Well, I got interested in all this stuff as hauntings, I suppose, which I came across at quite a young age. I used to stay in Wales, and the house I used to stay in used to have really odd things happening.
Mm-hmm.
A typical poltergeist, things disappearing and reappearing, and a bit later on, UFOs, which happened to see with other people, a large orange object in Holywell. Well, Holywell is it was a holy well as such, and still is. Is regarded the Lords of North Wales. The story goes, I can't remember the name. The person that beatified was had the head sliced off, and where it rolled down, the water sprang out, and that became the well. The father of the person apparently pleaded to God, and placed the head back on her head, which she miraculously came back to life. And then the ground opened up and swallowed the perpetrator. Above the well hill, there's a large hole in the ground, which is supposed to be where the perpetrator disappeared. And directly below it is the well. Saint Winifred, just come back to us now. And the statue has got a line around the neck. That the well is supposed to, or the well pool is supposed to. Curative, there's all sorts of stories with people being cured, and there's sorts of names and stuff along carved into the wall, and there's still the pool still there, and changing huts, and I must admit the water is icy cold because it comes straight down from the mountain there, and apparently the whole valley going down to the abbey at the bottom, which is apparently some groups have gone down for the allegedly saying it was haunted, but I didn't come across anything. Well, I used to live there, things they say they picked up on the train that used to run up and down, and the monks that used to inhabit the abbey. But the only story I heard was like a Rip Van Winkle story, which connected someone was supposed to fell asleep and then woke up many years later, and when they were touched, they sort of crumpled to dust, sort of thing. But I trace that story back. Watts Dyke runs into Hollywell, and that runs back further towards Denby, that story.
Yeah.
So somehow the two have been intertwined. But yeah, I didn't come across any other ghost stories there.
No. So I forgot that you know Nigel. John's.
Yeah.
He says you're a fantastic investigator.
Very kind. I'll pay you later.
He said of many years now. He said he knew you in the 1990s when you was doing UFO investigations.
Yeah. I'm to come across a story which Nigel's friend at the time, living in Ilkley area, discovered or rediscovered several ancient stone sites, including one called the Backstone Circle, which apparently overlooked by archaeologists amongst all these other sites. Up on the top of the moor is the swastika stone as well, which we were just talking about, the swastika symbology. Also, just across the moor is the where the very famous Faery site, and which is just escaped my memory what it was. Nigel might help us out. The whole area around there was Nigel investigated really thoroughly, included all kinds of ghost stories and black dogs, UFOs, strange creatures, otherworldly stuff with the ancient sites. Nigel fill us in on the detail on that.
So you've been, as he says, you've been doing this for years. So when it comes to ghosts, what's your theory? What do you think they are?
I haven't come to any particular theory because it seems to change from location to location.
Yeah.
You could have the stone tape theory, which is a replay, but that all people don't experience the same thing. That's what I've come across. Some can have a very vivid experience and some experience nothing. You can go to some places, absolutely nothing will happen. Be like going to fishing. On one occasion you go somewhere and you'll have amazing things happen, and it's not always particularly good. And on one or two occasions I've been to certain places where it's been particularly bad. And physical experience of people be actually being ill before seeing an apparition, a huge black apparition, physically ill, and I still don't know why they were. The only thing I can come across that was some sort of radiation poisoning, which would affect your system entirely. Now, there's about 5-6 people seeing this simultaneously. Come out of nowhere and went into the building, and that's why we were at the particular location, because we're investigating. I'll be asked to come in and try and see if this thing was actually physically real. Things have experienced on the stairwell, and huge temperature drops, and electrical malfunctions, telephone and alarm systems, and that was right throughout this building. And it was over a site which had in the area experienced UFO activity as well, amongst other things. So it seemed to be numerous things, but I've been on some investigations. It could be quite amusing as well. I mentioned one location, which is Chingle Hall, which is now off limits to all investigators.
Shut up. Oh, I just wish people had stopped mentioning Chingle Hall.
Bloody hole, 'cause we can't go.
No.
I mean, Nigel mentioned on there the Cottingley Fairies.
Cottingley Fairies, that's what it was. Yeah.
Tom and Denaria makes people feel ill and sickly. Yeah, yeah. Jeanette keeps going on about that, doesn't she? Because she lives there. Too many Johns here. There is definitely too many Johns here. Doc Savage. too many Johns. I don't know. Three hills, high hills above the town, which seem to come close you in, he said.
Nigel said there's lots of UFOs in Tuddy.
Yeah, lots of UFO sightings. Andy said, I remember seeing a TV that mentioned Todmorden, TV program that mentioned Todmorden.
Todmorden had the famous UFO police sighting on the main road, which a well-known UFO investigator called Jenny Randalls was written in several of her books and gone into detail. But other investigators from the Yorkshire area, Andy Roberts in particular, he sort of decried it as they had an alternative reality sort of experience where a bus became the UFO, basically. He sort of had a dream sequence when he fell asleep. Something sort of put him into a mini sleep, and he experienced all these weird and strange things, but it was only a normal object. There was a small house along the road which resembled a UFO, so it was a modern house. Well, it was on the main road, but other police experienced similar things in the same area around the same time. So it's still open, because the officer in particular, he hasn't never said it wasn't
a UFO.
Yeah.
Andy said, yeah, it was on Strange But True with Michael Aspel.
That's it, yeah.
And Helen said, Keith Lee's weird too.
Yeah. Nigel says, Alan Godfrey encounter. There was a black dog on the UFO. On the UFO?
On the UFO, yeah.
Taking the mic.
God, I tell
you. Black dogs and UFOs.
But it's everywhere, isn't it? Yep, and yep. I've always said, some people can't just be making this up. You know what I mean? There's too many sightings. You know, we get them every day coming through on the news feed of most of them's in America, they're seeing all these UFOs. Can we see a few more over here? You know, but
I think the biggest problem today is that we don't look.
Yes, this is it.
We're so embroiled in our own lives that
if
you bother to look, we'd probably see a lot more UFOs, a lot more the fairy folk, so to speak. I'll say fairy folk as one big.
Yeah,
because obviously there's lots of different little ones involved there. But if you just bother to open your eyes and look.
Well, Deb actually agrees with you there. So, but it's like, you know, there's quite a few people that believe in this, isn't there? And some people go really into it, you know, and believe in stuff because they're actually... they'd rather watch TV instead of getting outside and looking. Yeah, you're right. Many a times when we've gone down on a Wednesday night, a couple of times you've said ta-da to Neil when he's been here. I think he's brought them, actually. But and you've seen something up in the sky that hasn't looked right.
Yeah, many times. I'm just trying to work out this one.
What's this? We got back from Drakelow. Yeah, you saw something, didn't you?
Yes, I saw it in the sky. I didn't know.
Yeah.
It didn't... I thought it could have been a space station, because it definitely didn't look like a star.
No, it could be a satellite, a numerous satellites whizzing around. Which,
Andy said, speak for yourself, he's always looking at the skies.
Yeah. Well, I mean, some of us do, but I mean, in general, we're so impacted in our own little lives that we don't bother to look around us.
Shut up, Nigel, I'll be deleting that when I do the cast. Oh, God, somebody's come in called the Devil Inside. Why didn't the aliens retrieve their crashed ship and crew at Roswell if they are so high-tech? Well, there's a question.
Well, it was either real or it was a hoax, so take your choice.
I wonder if that's supposed to be the Devil Ian inside.
I I mean, the problem you've got with that is that nobody actually knows the truth as yet. I mean, there's lots of theories. A lot of people say it did happen.
Mm.
A lot of people say they actually found the people that was in control of the ship and rather lost control of it.
Yeah.
There's just too much misinformation.
Well, though the other thing was it could be a secret government craft based on the Nazi stuff they took from Germany, a flying wing.
Yeah, because they were working on flying saucers as well, weren't they? At one point.
See, you can't fool me, Ian.
Well, we all know they got the bases on the moon, don't we? You know.
Oh yeah,
definitely. So. I spelt my name wrong, Dan. So, but I don't know. But as I say, it is an interesting subject. It's one that can go on and on and on and on until we, if we ever do find answers. There is a guy in America. He's, I don't know who he is, but there's rumours that he's not very reliable. You know, but he reckons he's finally found proof that he's recorded a spirit or caught a spirit on camera, according to one of the feeds I got. But going on to UFOs, no, sorry, onto a different matter, which is zombies. Just to quickly brief onto this, a man actually contacted me. He's written a book about zombies. Yeah. Now, I don't know what you all think of zombies, but it's a subject that, not that I'm actually interested in. But when we was on Zone Unknown, yeah.
Oh, that was a brilliant.
We had a brilliant conversation. I'm going to try and get the guy on the show, if I can, to see whether he can actually come and talk to us about his experience when he went over to Haiti or wherever it was, and about the actual truth about zombies. And I've got a feeling it's got something to do with the serpent and the, what was it? Ian, what was it? You mentioned it, I'm sure you did.
I can't remember.
I
know he was...
But anyway, and he's talking about a book. But saying that, I went onto his website, and I can't really find it where it is now. I don't know whether you've got it on here.
Probably not.
I went onto his website.
Serpent and the Rainbow, said Lee.
Serpent and the... That's it. I went onto his web... Oh, there he is, your show. D.A. Roberts, he's called. Right. And I went onto his website, which I'm just going onto here. And I'll be honest with you, he's got one subject. He's written a couple of books called The Awakening and The Reckoning. And he's got zombie gear and only in America. But I must admit, if you go into one of his pages, where is it?
Yeah, he's got a lot of stuff about the recent
stuff. Zombie in the News, yeah. It's entitled, I Guess It's Time to Get a Shotgun, right? There are cases of zombie attacks, and you've got the when I say zombie, you've got the Pennsylvania zombie.
It's supposed to be to do with that bathtub.
Yeah, I know, but some of it isn't. That one about the Miami one, there was an update on it that actually said there was just a little marijuana in his tox results. That means he either decided to eat this homeless man's face on his own, or he is really a zombie. You know what I mean? But you've got to listen to it. This is just 2012 yeah. alone, right?
I mean, it would seem to be rather fortuitous that a lot of people have it. But, I mean, it's...
But just...
It could be a psychic episode.
Yeah, well, just on 2012 alone, you've got the Pennsylvania zombie, right? You've got yet another one in Florida. The Naked in Florida, which is the Miami one, right? Yeah, which you've got an update on that. You've got the Baltimore Cannibal. You've got... hazmat teams in Florida. You've got Florida zombie scare. Another Florida attack. Lafayette zombie attack. Montreal dismemberment. The Naples incident. San Antonio cannibal. Hackensack attack. Wacko in Wacko. And the Chinese zombie. Now, come on. What the hell is going on over there, Mr. Savage?
But we're talking about... The Hollywood type zombie, because zombies, as in the Haiti kind of zombie, don't eat people.
No, they don't eat people, but they are actually
not yet.
No, they have this sort of stuff or something, isn't it?
it's actually the ultimate. Whereas Christian says hell and damnation is the ultimate thing to on voodoo, the ultimate punishment is to be a zombie.
Yeah.
Because you have no will of your own completely, and it's done with a powder.
Well, when we had this guy on Zone Unknown, you got Roy Basnett there going, does anyone want to ask any questions? You're like, no, let him go on. Let him speak. It was so riveting. Doc Savage said, it's all Obama's fault.
there was four of us in the studio, weren't we? And none of us wanted to interrupt this guy. We just wanted to listen
to him. Yeah, we just wanted to listen to him. It was just so fascinating. You know, Mark and Jebby and all that were there, and it's like, no, let him carry on. But it was really, really good. If I can get this guy on, it'll be brilliant. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, but I'll see if I can get hold of him.
And also, we want to get hold of the lady that actually
flew through the Bermuda Triangle. That would be good, because she was quite riveting. Yeah, The Serpent and the Rainbow is a great book and film.
The interesting thing with that one was, I mean, she had a full tank of fuel when she left.
Mm.
She got herself turned around and everything, and she managed to get through and land, and she assumed it was just like an hour or so, but it when she landed, she actually got a rollicking because for not filling up, and yet she filled up, but she'd used a full tank of fuel.
Mm. Yeah, zombies.
Just to go a short distance.
Yeah, so you got the missing time.
Yeah. Well, just on that little snippet we've just spoke about, you've got they've come up with here zombies. Dev says Jesus was a zombie.
So was Captain Scarlet.
Dark Side of the Moon. Watch Jesse Ventura Conspiracy Theories, awesome program about zombie apocalypse. I tell you, in one ancient religion, they used to put rocks in the mouth of the dead to supposedly prevent them from coming back and using their primary weapons. Morph was arrested too, says Nigel. Or somebody said Morph was arrested too.
He was a
Play-Doh file. Oh, that was John, typical. Sure, but, it's something that's happening now, isn't it, really? In some way, shape or form. You know what I mean? It's all about people in some sort of psychotic, zoned out thing going round ripping people's skin off and eating it.
Apparently we taste like chicken.
Apparently. Yeah, because cannibals eat it and all. But going back to Andy, I saw that one there. So about do you do voodoo? I don't do voodoo. I don't know who that was for, but
by today's standards, if we was to eat human beings,
yeah,
we'd be very sick after a short period of time.
Apparently, yeah.
Because we're not capable of handling it.
No.
For toxic chemicals.
Yeah, and you, I think you've got to be in some state of hunger to eat a person. You know what I mean? So
it happened on that crash on the Andean Mountains, didn't it? They
did it?
Yeah. They slowly ate each other.
God.
To stay alive, yeah.
Stay alive.
Yeah.
As people died off, they ate them.
Mm. So what do you reckon? If we can get this guy on, we can talk about these zombies. What do you think?
You're
don't like the skin.
Sam said the Uruguay rugby team in 1977. Tell us more.
But what do you think? Should we get this guy on to talk about his book and maybe see if we can get the guy on that actually spoke to us about this?
I want
to
watch the film. Tell us.
Yeah, Brad Pitt's doing a zombie movie at the moment.
I think the chickens have gone tonight. Oh, I hope you haven't heard them. So, but anyway, time is coming to a close, unfortunately.
Yes, we have to get John back to the...
Coming soon.
So what have we got on next week? Well, ladies and gentlemen, the lineup for next week, we have two guests on. We have Yari McCullough coming on at 8:30. Now, Yari is putting together this show in Edinburgh next year called The Spirit... Oh, God. And Science, I think it is. Let me just double check. I've forgotten what it's called now. Let me just go and check.
I have to get it right.
Yes, I have to get it right because I've got to advertise it more. Right, the Spirits, Shadows and Secrets International Symposium. You can find out more at, when it comes up, spiritsandshadows.com. Okay. And it tells you quite a few there. It's on the 26th of August to the 1st of September 2013. And you've got some great guys coming over. You've got Michael J. Murphy, which I've never heard of, but these are all part of this sort of lot. Mika Hanks, Dr. Robert M. Scooch, Dr. Lynn D. Kaite, loads of people. Let me just see if I can go to the speakers and it will tell us exactly what's going on here. If you're going to go, you need to book your place now for your accommodation, because this is on the last day of the Fringe and it's on for a whole week. You've got Anthony F. Sanchez, who is a ufologist, conspiracy theorist and an author. You've got Bill Murphy, who's a paranormal investigator and from Paranormal Fact and Fate and probably other programs that we don't get at the moment. You've got people like Chip Kofi, who's a psychic medium and author. You've also got a guy here called Darren Sereda, who's a director and filmmaker and author. David Waverley. You've also got, let's see if I can find some names that I actually know. Joshua P. Warren, he's coming on. Mari D. Jones, ufologist and paranormal and time traveller. Let me see. Nick Redfern, he's going to be there. Who else? Robert Cracknell, psychic and author. Thomas P. Fusco, who's a physics, spiritualist and paranormalist. Yvonne R. Smith. There's quite a few on there if you want to go and have a look. They cover a lot of things, ufology and paranormal investigating and quite a lot of stuff. We've even got, who told me about it in the first place, is our very own friend, Ben Hansen. He's going as well. So all those that love Ben Hansen, or Hansen, he's there as well. So it's next year. But he's going to come and tell us all about it next week. And he's also into the paranormal and crystals and stuff like that. So he's going to also talk about his own experience as well. Then after we've spoken to Yari, who's going... Where did he say he was? Helsinki, I think he is. We're going to come home, so to speak, because we will be talking to a really good friend of ours, Ian Timothy. And we're going to be talking dreams. So if you've got any dreams that you've had... This is a chance. I've finally got him on the show to come and talk to us about his dreamology and what have you. So he's going to come and talk to us about dreams and stuff like that.
So we need some dreams emailed to us.
Yes. So yeah,
I've got a dream of winning the lottery.
That ain't going to happen. you don't need Ian.
apparently that's not about money.
No.
Believe it or not.
But as I say, if you've got any dreams, you need to email them in. All right, before the show next week, admin.co.uk, ktpf.co.uk, rather, and put in the subject, my dreams, and then we will put them to Ian Timothy, and hopefully you'll get some synopsis on them and find out what exactly everything's all about. So, as I say, we've come to the end of the show, so don't forget...
Deb's going to email loads in, she says.
I know.
Every Wednesday night.
Yep, you know where to find us, ladies and gentlemen. So, what happened there? We're doing it now. Wait! Right.
This is where it's at.
Yep, this is where it's at. And, oh God, we're there again. Oh, don't go. We've got nothing to talk about. So I think that's about it for tonight. That's a wrap. So until next time.
Nigel's give us the numbers. 314-65-40-73.
Thanks,
Nige. There's only one thing wrong with that. It only goes up to 49.
Yeah. Yeah, that's well, 46. All right.
Yeah, unless it's the Euros. I think the Euros does higher.
So Rachel says, great show again, Night. We'll see you all next week. We'll see you all next week. And until next time, ladies and gentlemen, keep the paranormal friendly. Good night and God bless.
Good night.
Night, guys.